Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and welcome to this, the Ardingly College Chapel, for our annual musical commemoration of Remembrance. We are gathered here to commemorate musically and through readings and literature those who are lost through conflict or afflicted by such devastating events. In the chapel tonight, we have the lower six year group, readers and musicians and singers alike, whilst we have a collection of different pre-recorded videos from all walks of the college community. Of course, this is not our only remembrance event. We have Wednesday's live commemoration at 11 a.m. However, this concert has been put together over the course of the last few weeks. This is, of course, being streamed live to your living rooms or the boarding houses here in the college, and therefore takes on a slightly different form to its usual guise. However, practically speaking, you should be able to see a program on the right-hand side of your YouTube link there or in the Vimeo presentation. Please do follow that as the course of the concert unfurls. Of course, this event wouldn't happen without the help and support of many people behind the scenes, and this is a fairly epic affair to make this evening's music and literature happen. Firstly, I'd just like to thank two of the graduate assistants, Miss Rainbird Early and Miss Birch, for their support with all the music making, Mr. Smith for his support with prep school choirs, Miss GB, the head of singing, Miss Gilmore Bailey, for all of her support, particularly with the lower six choir that you will hear later. And of course, the technical team of Mr. Freer, and we have a new assistant this evening, Tom, who has come in at last minute, but I won't say why. Finally, of course, we have Mr. Potsuto, who has commandeered this whole event. So my sincerest thanks to him for everything that he has done. So without further ado, I hope you're sitting nice and comfortably in your living room, in the boarding house, wherever it may be. Please take this time just to reflect on what remembrance means for you, but also, of course, in the context of history, an amazingly powerful musical and literary movement, reflecting all of those who tragically gave their lives for our freedom here in the 21st century. So without further ado, I invite for you to listen, not to the stage, the Remove Brass Group, who will play for you the very, very famous and completely appropriate hymn, Abide With Me.
Thank you. All day and night, save winter, every weather, above the inn, the smithy and the shop, the aspens at the crossroads talk together, of rain until their last leaves fall from the top. Out of the blacksmith cabin comes a ring of hammer, shoe and anvil, out of the inn. The clink, the hum, the roar, the random singing, the sounds that for these 50 years have been. The whisper of the aspens is not drowned, and over lightless pane and footless road, emptier sky with every other sound, not ceasing, calls their ghost from their abode. A silent smithy, a silent inn, nor fails, in the bare moonlight or the thick furred gloom, in tempest or the night of nightingales, to turn the crossroads to a ghostly room. And it would be the same, were no house near, over all sorts of weather, men and times. Aspens must shake their leaves, and men may hear, but need not listen more than to my rhymes. Whatever wind blows, while day and I have leaves, we cannot other than an aspen be, that ceaselessly unreasonably grieves, or so men think who like a different tree.
You those long, uneven lines, standing as patiently as if they were stretched outside the Oval or Villa Park. The crowns of hats, the sun on moustached archaic faces, grinning as if it were all an August bank holiday lark. And the shut shops, the bleached established names on the sun blinds, the farthings and sovereigns, and dark-clothed children at play called after kings and queens. The tin advertisements for cocoa and twist, and the pubs wide open all day. And the countryside not caring, the place names all hazed over with flowering grasses and fields shadowing doomsday lines under wheat's restless silence. The differently dressed servants with tiny rooms and huge houses, the dust behind limousines. Never such innocence. Never before or since has changed itself to past without a word. The men leaving the gardens tidy, the thousands of marriages lasting a little while longer. Never such innocence again.
Captain, see to understand, because the next day when I was at the pen, and now the Humpty Jumps beneath his reveille. He's the boogie boogie bugle boy from baby. A root, a tooth, a tooth to the other tooth, he blows into the barn. A boogie rhythm, that we know, unless the basic guitar is playing with me. And the company jumps beneath this reveille. He's the boogie boogie bugle boy from baby. Because the voices seem to fill the air every night, and wakes them up the same way in the early bright. They clap their hands and stamp their feet, because they know how it plays. It's called the get to the beat. It really breaks it up beneath this reveille. He's the boogie boogie bugle boy from beneath me. A root, a tooth, a tooth to the other tooth, he blows into the bar. In boogie rhythm, you can't play it low unless the basic guitar is playing you in. And the company jumps beneath his reveille. He's the boogie boogie bugle boy of company B.
These are the damned circles Dante trod, terrible in hopelessness, but even skulls have their humour, an eyeless and sardonic mockery. And we, sitting with streaming eyes in the acrid smoke that murks our foul damp billet, chant bitterly with raucous voices as a choir of frogs in hideous irony our patriotic songs.
Thank you.
The rank stench of those bodies haunts me still, and I remember things I'd best forget. For now we've marched to a green, trenchless land, 12 miles from battering guns along the grass. Brown lines of tents are hives for snoring men. Wide, radiant water sways the floating sky, below dark, shivering trees, and living clean. Comes back with thoughts of home and hours of sleep. Tonight I smell the battle miles away. Gun thunder leaps and thuds along the ridge. The spouting shells dig pits in fields of death, and wounded men are moaning in the woods. If any friend be there whom I have loved, Godspeed him safe to England with a gash. It's sundown in the camp, some youngsters laugh, lifting his mug and drinking health to all who come unscathed from that unpitying waste. Terror and ruin lurk behind his gaze. Another sits with tranquil, musing face, puffing his pipe and dreaming of the girl whose last scrawled letter lies upon his knee. The sunlight falls, low, ruddy from the west, upon their heads. Last week they might have died, and now they stretch their limbs in tired content. One says, the bloody Boche has got the knock, and soon they'll crumple up and chuck their games. We've got the beggars on the run at last. Then I remembered someone that I'd seen, dead in a squalid, miserable ditch, heedless of toiling feet that trod him down. He was a Prussian with a decent face, young, fresh, and pleasant, so I dare to say. No doubt he loathed the water and longed for peace, and cursed our souls because we killed his friends. One night he yawned along a half-dug trench. Midnight, and then British guns began, with heavy shrapnel bursting low, and howls whistling to cut the wire with a blinding din. He didn't move, the digging still went on. Men stooped and shoveled, someone gave a grunt, and moaned and died with agony in the sludge. Then the long hiss of shells lifted and stopped. He stared into the gloom, a rock curved, and rifles rattled angrily on the left, down by the wood, and there was noise of bombs. Then the Dan English loomed in scrambling haste, out of the dark and struggled through the wire. And there were shouts and curses, someone screamed, and men began to blunder down the trench with their rifles. It was time to go. He grabbed his coat, stood up, gulping some bread, then clutched his head and fell. I found him there in the grey morning where the place was held. His face was in the mud, one arm flung out, and when he crumpled up, his sturdy legs were bent beneath his trunk, heels to the sky.
Oh, By the time you read this, I shall have been called to make with many others the greatest sacrifice of all, and my last long leave will have been taken. I don't want you to grieve or show any signs of loss. I've only done what many others already have done. I can never tell you how thankful I am for the happy home and comforts I've received from you all. I know it will be hard, but be as cheerful over this parting as possible, and then set out to find a home where perhaps the bread earner has been called away, and be a comfort and help to them. With love to all, and do not grieve, Charlie.
That you're fairer than a lot of girls, just as pleasing. That I doff my hat as a worshipper at your shrine. It's not that you're rarer than asparagus out of season. No, my darling, this is the reason why you've got to be mine. You'd be so nice to come home to. You'd be so nice by the fire, while the breeze on high sang a lullaby. You'd be all that I could desire, under stars by the winter, under an August moon burning above. You'd be so nice, you'd could be a paradise to go home to and love. Under stars chilled by the winter, under an August moon burning above, you'd be so nice, you'd be paradise to come home to and love.
We pure no more sad hearts. dared believe through slow and savage years is all our own. That summit which we willed we now achieve, and certainty deposes the unknown. Through dragon's country midnight black we went, where one Apollyon had as much in mind, and set whatever deaths he could invent. Above, beneath, about, that lies behind, a widening wonder glitters on our view. That tyranny is overpassed, once more we have come through. Immense the scene, the drama measureless, which aftercomers with astonished eyes will long survey and struggle to express. The problem huge, the countering enterprise. When time makes plain the action in all parts, discloses things in crisis as yet hid, then will the world, with eloquence of arts, forever crown what these free spirits did. We may not voice them yet, the dawn's still new. We live triumph now, no artist ever drew. To trace the roads which led us to this hour, history shall be proud, and honour fill her hall with colours. Let those bright works flower in their due season. We are mindful still of yesternight's red shadows and fierce toil, of this man's death and that man's masterstroke, of years turned ages on an alien soil, of fiery horrors whelming patient folk, of weapon craft beyond what any knew, blastings, soul witherings, hungers, eyes of death on you. And from the distance, from the far sundered lands, came men and women leaving all they had into the battlefields of scorching sands and houseless wastes and plains obscure and sad, for nothing that should be a personal gain, but to ensure the best should still prevail. The sky was flashing with their quick disdain of danger. Under sea they would assail. The creed they counted worse than death. Their crew swept the broad sea till nothing showed there to pursue. These in their multitude, and more than these, dying and suffering, companied, alone, their faces, voices, humours, tragedies, their will, their skill, now intimately known. And those their leaders of one mind to frame vast strategies from which escape was none, and all their actions rise to future fame. Be theirs sweet peace, dear love, kind rain and sun, the life for which they inarched and sailed and flew, reunion, restoration, freedom, deep and true. But could our striving wishes bring us back those who in youth, those golden hearts and heads, who fell untimely by the cratered track, the vision would excel what now it sheds of blessing on this world. How shall we then, but by their memory rule what lies before, and from their genius light such ways that men, through such convulsion, never favour more? Thence shall the final victory ever new sing in the lives of all that live, we have come through.
and never let me go. Your eyes will tell me all I want to know when you come once more. We'll learn to love anew the simple joys we knew and share together night and day. We'll watch without a sigh the moment speeding by when life is free and hearts are gay. My dream is here for you to share, and in my because of prayer, we'll gather lilacs in the spring again and walk together down an English lane until our hearts have learned to sing again. When you come home and in the evening by the twilight's glow, you'll hold me close and never let me go. Your eyes will tell me all I want to know when you come.
Thank you. If you should die, think only this of me, in that still quietness where is space for thought, where parting, loss, and bloodshed shall not be, and men may rest themselves and dream of naught, that in some place, a mystical mile away, one whom you love has drained the bitter cup, till there is naught to drink, has faced the day once more, and now has raised the standard up. And think, my son, with eyes grown clear and dry, she lives as though forever in your sight, loving the things you loved with heart aglow for country, honor, truth, tradition tie, proud that you paid their price. And if some night her heart should break, well, lad, you will not know.
The flowers left thick and nightfall in the wood. This eastern tide caught into mind the man. Now far from home, who with her sweetheart should have gathered them and will do never again.